I need everybody to clap your hands. Sing along with me.
All right. Y'all come on in. To God be the glory. Amen. To God be the glory. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice in it. Amen. Amen. Good morning. I'm excited, man. I always say that, but I am. I'm always excited to share in the teaching messages, man, that God gives me. So that I can teach you how to win in life. Amen. So that's what it's all about. God wants you to win. And you have to believe that no matter what's going on in your life, no matter what you're dealing with, no matter what you're going through, you have to believe that. Amen. And so this morning, I want to share this message with you guys that is really, I believe, going to make some sense out of probably some of the adversity that you may have been going through or may be going through even at this time. So it is important for us to understand that God does not waste anything. You know, the good times, the bad times, the ups, the downs, the storms, they all have purpose for why God allows them to happen in our life. So this morning, I want to talk to you guys from the title message, Growing Through. That's what I want to talk to you guys about this morning. I want to talk to you guys about the message entitled Growing Through. We're all going through, but are we growing through? All of us go through, but do we grow through? And that's what I want to talk to you about today, because ultimately God wants us to grow in our faith, grow in our walk with Him, and grow in our connection with Him. So God's expectation for those who have accepted Jesus Christ is for us to grow. And that's what is so important about when you go through, are you really growing through? So let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you this morning that I have the privilege and the honor to speak into the lives of your people. God, I pray that you will anoint this message afresh, Lord God. I pray that you would anoint every ear that is listening, that they would hear the revelation that you want to manifest in their lives, oh God. Father, I pray that this message would fall on fertile soil, Lord God, and that it would bring forth fruit. God, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this time that we have to share in your word. So bless us, God. Speak to us in the name of Jesus. Use me, Father God. Speak to me and speak through me. You will get the glory. You will get the honor. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 So this morning I'm going to be talking about growing through. Growing through. Amen. I think this is something that is really going to bless you. Why? Because God wants you to win. Listen, I am convinced nobody can change my mind. Nothing can make me feel differently. No matter what I face, no matter what I go through, ultimately, I know that God wants me to win. And you have to believe that without a shadow of a doubt. You have to believe that no matter what you're going through at this time. And watch this, you have to understand, sometimes losing is a part of the winning process. Amen. I've had a lot of losses, but those losses have been a part of my winning. So here we go. God's expectation. Watch this. God's expectation for those who accept Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior is that they leave the entry level of Christianity and grow up and mature in their walk with Him. That's God's expectation. See, when we get born again, when we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, that is our entry into the kingdom of God. That is our entry into the beginning of our faith walk. So when you accept Christ, That is just the beginning. That is not the end. So when we accept Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, we enter in at the entry level of Christianity. But God's expectation is for us to grow. See, it's just like a little child, a little baby. When they're born, you expect them to cry. You expect them to crawl. You expect them to whine. You expect them to poop on themselves. You expect them to throw up. Why? Because they're newborn babes. But as they get older, your expectation of them is that they would, is that their behavior, their actions would coincide and line up with their age or what is supposed to be them growing up. And so as it is with God, you know, God expects us, God has an expectation of us after we have gotten born again to grow. He wants us to grow. In fact, watch this. The scriptures challenge us to grow. The scriptures challenge us to mature in our walk with God. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 2 says this, like newborn babies crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow in your salvation. Did y'all get that? Watch this, I'm gonna read it again. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 2, like newborn babies crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow in your salvation. Grow in your salvation. Don't just stay the same after you've gotten saved. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18 says this, but grow in grace, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But grow in the grace. See, when we get born again, we receive the grace of God. And once we get born again and we receive the grace of God, that's why the scripture says grow in the grace. When God graces your life, what he does is he holds certain things back from happening when we mess up because he knows we're growing. So he graces us in situations because he knows that we're growing and he expects growth. So 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18 says this again, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hebrews 6 and 1 says this in the Message version. Listen to the Message version, y'all. The Message version is very point blank. The Message version says this, Hebrews chapter 6, verse number 1. So come on. Let's leave the preschool finger painting exercises on Christ and get on with the grand work of art. Grow up in Christ. Hebrews 6 and 1 in the Message version basically says, man, grow up. So there is an expectation of God that we grow after we get born again, that we don't just stay at the entry level of salvation. Now, one of the ways that God, you know, one of the ways that we grow in God is through adversity. One of the ways that we grow in God is through adversity. And so when adversity happens in our lives or happens in your life, are you going to go through or are you going to grow through? That's the question. When adversity happens in your life, are you going to go through or are you going to grow through? See, I believe that one of the reasons that God allows adversity in our lives is because, watch this, adversity brings growth. That's what 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 18 is talking about. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. God will grace us to grow through adversity. So watch this. The scriptures are filled with examples of people who faced adversity and on the other side of their experience discovered how God worked through their adversity to bring about growth and progress in their life. I'll say that again. The scriptures are filled with examples of people who faced adversity, and on the other side of their experience, they discovered how God worked through their adversity to bring about growth, maturity, and progress. So watch this. God uses adversity to help us grow. So in other words, don't just go through adversity, grow through adversity. Remember Joseph? Joseph experienced betrayal. He experienced slavery. He experienced being lied on. He experienced imprisonment before becoming the second in command in Pharaoh's kingdom. See, Joseph grew through what he was going through. And then what Pharaoh did was he promoted him. On the other side of adversity, Joseph walked into growth, maturity, progress, and success. You see, what happens is the devil wants you to think that all you're going to deal with is adversity. He wants you to think that all you're going to have is trouble in life. But the reality of it is, and I'm a living witness, there is growth on the other side of adversity. There is success on the other side of your sorrow. There is triumph on the other side of your trial. You just have to grow through what you're going through. And so think about it. Daniel was a captive first in Babylon, but he was later promoted to the highest level of government in the kingdom. See, on the other side of what you're going through is success, maturity, blessings, and you will win. But you have to grow through it to get to it. See, watch this. David spent many years running from King Saul, but on the other side of his adversity, David became the king of Israel, one of the greatest kings, if not the greatest earthly king that Israel had ever had. See, Job lost everything, all of his earthly possessions and his children. But on the other side of adversity, watch this, y'all, he learned some things about God that he could have only learned through adversity. And then God gave him double for his trouble on the other side of adversity. I don't know who that word is for, but I'm telling you, I hear it in my spirit. God is saying to someone right now that is going through adversity, God is saying to you, don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. Don't call it quits. You can win. On the other side is your breakthrough. On the other side of adversity is your deliverance. On the other side of adversity, God has blessings waiting for you. So don't give up now because you're going through adversity. There's another side to this thing. And that's what you have to do. So there may be some pain, but the end result of adversity is all about growth, maturity, and progress in life. And so you have to understand something. During our seasons of adversity, God is trying to stretch us. God is trying to grow us. But watch this. God is trying to stretch us and God is trying to grow us, but the devil is trying to defeat us and the devil is trying to destroy us. The devil is trying to accomplish at least four things during our seasons of adversity. The devil wants us to do four things when we go through adversity. Number one, he wants us to walk away from God. When adversity happens in our lives, God is stretching us and growing us and maturing us, but the devil is trying to destroy us and defeat us. And so there's four things that the devil hopes we will do when we face adversity. Number one, he hopes we will walk away from God. For some people, if the Lord doesn't deliver them right away, some people become so disappointed because they're facing adversity that they walk away from God. And that's exactly what the enemy wants. Number two, the devil wants us to doubt the reality of God. See, watch this. Since the Lord let adversity happen in your life, you may question whether he is who he says he is in the Bible. So when we face adversity, the devil is hoping that we will doubt the reality of God. If God was real, why am I going through what I'm going through? Number three, the devil wants us to blame God. When adversity happens in our lives, because God didn't prevent the situation, some people decide that it's his fault. In other words, watch this. He could have stopped it if he wanted to, if he's God. So I'm blaming him for what happened to my marriage. I'm blaming him for what happened to my child. I'm blaming him for losing my job. I'm blaming him for going through the divorce. God, you let it happen. I'm blaming you. See, that's what the devil wants. And then number four, he wants us to reject the word of God. You see, when it seems as if the word of God is not working in our lives during our times of adversity, some people close the Bible thinking that God doesn't keep his promises that are found in the scriptures. So you got to understand something. When adversity happens in our lives, God is trying to stretch us and grow us. God is trying to develop us and mature us. But the devil is trying to destroy us, and the devil, watch this, the devil is trying to destroy us, and the devil is trying to defeat us. And so the devil wants us to do at least four things when adversity happens. He wants us to walk away from God. He wants us to doubt the reality of God. He wants us to blame God. And then he wants us to reject the Bible. Listen, remember when Job went through what he went through? His wife came to him and she basically blamed God. She said, Job, where's your God? Man, you ought to curse God and die. Why would God let this happen to you, Job? See, that's what the devil wants. When we go through adversity in life, the devil wants us to blame God. He wants us to walk away from God. He wants us to doubt the reality of God. And he wants us to reject the word of God. Now watch this. And so what should be our response during seasons and times of adversity? How do we respond when adversity happens in our lives? Or how should we respond? How do we grow through what we're going through? There's three things that I want to release in your spirit, three life principles that we need to understand. See, during seasons of adversity, during times of adversity, what should our response be? How should we respond? How do we grow through what we're going through? Here it is. Y'all, somebody write this down. Here's the first life principle. Someone type this in for me. We should turn to God. Watch this. Even if our choices caused the adversity. Man, y'all got to get this. Oh my God, y'all got to get this. What should we do when adversity happens? What should we do when trouble comes? What should we do when we're facing our mountains? What should we do when we're going through? See, here it is. Watch this. Number one, here's the first life principle. Someone type this in for me. We should turn to God even if our choices caused the adversity. See, watch this. In Luke chapter number 15, verse number 18, watch this. Luke chapter number 15, verse number 18. The prodigal son has chosen to leave his father's house. The prodigal son went to his father and made a choice. He said, give me my inheritance. I want to go and live my life. He made a choice. And when he made this choice to leave his father's house, he went out into a foreign country. And the Bible says he wasted everything on riotous living. He finds himself, now you got to understand something, of course you guys know this, he's a Jew. And Jews had nothing to do with swine or pigs. But as a result of his choice, he finds himself in the pig pen. He finds himself in the pig pen. Watch this. So the son had every reason not to return back to his father, because he had made the choice, and as a result of his choices, watch this, he found himself in the position that he was in. Now watch this. The scripture says something very interesting. The scripture says that he came to himself. You see, adversity has a way. My God, I hope y'all get this. Adversity has a way of reminding us how good God is. Now, let me rephrase that. Adversity has a way of reminding us how good God has been to us. See, when the prodigal son realized that his choices had caused his adversities, the Bible says he came to him. So what did he, what he came to himself? What do you mean? He started thinking about how good his father had been to them. My Lord Jesus, watch this, y'all. Watch this. The son had every reason not to turn back to God. Listen, he was dealing with shame because look at him now. He's in the pig pen. He was dealing with guilt. You know, he probably was saying, I shouldn't have never left. He was dealing with failure. He had no more money, no more friends, nothing. He was living, he was dealing with dishonor because he had left his father's house. He had dishonored his father. And so all of these things that he was experiencing would make the average person say, God doesn't want anything to do with me. Now here it is, watch this. When our bad choices cause adversity, most of us think that we get what we deserve. When our bad choices cause adversity in our lives, and I've been there, I've made some really bad choices, and I felt like, okay, I get what I deserve. But see, watch this. There will always be consequences for our bad choices, but God's grace will always be available for us to turn back to him, for us to come back to him. And watch this. That's why the first life lesson is this. What do I do when adversity hits my life? What do I do when I'm the reason why I'm going through what I'm going through? What do I do when I made the bad choice? Here it is, the first life lesson. We should turn to God even if our choices cause the adversity. See, the devil will make you think that, well, you brought this on yourself. Well, this is the consequences of your bad decisions. Well, yeah, there are consequences to bad decisions, but there is also grace. Oh, good God from Zion. There is also grace. That's why Romans chapter 5, verse number 20 says this, where sin abounds, grace abounds much more. See, God will grace you to go through what you're going through if you just turn back to him when you're dealing with adversity. See, the prodigal son left his father's house, left his father's presence, left his father's teaching, left his father, but his father showed him grace when he came back. There is nothing that we can do to destroy God's grace. There is no choice that we can make to destroy the grace of God on our lives. See, let me tell you something, y'all. I have made a lot of bad choices. I have done a lot of bad things. But God graced me to get through them. Why? Because his design or his purpose was for me to grow through what I was going through. He didn't let me go through it to destroy me. He let me go through it because that was how growth was going to manifest. Oh, my Lord, have mercy. Are y'all getting this? Man, are y'all getting this? Oh, Lord, have mercy. Watch this. So even when we cause adversity on ourselves, God's grace is there to get us through what we're going through, to get us through the consequences of our bad choices, because God is going to help us grow through it. See, watch this. Man, listen, God's grace is amazing. Psalm 4, verse number 1 says this. Psalm 4, verse number 1 says, be gracious to me and hear my prayer. Give me grace. Give me grace, God. Watch this. Psalm 50 and 15 says this, and call upon me in the day of trouble, adversity. Watch this. And I will come. Even if you cause the trouble, call on God. Even if your choice caused the trouble, run back to God. Even if you're the reason why you're going through, walk back, turn back, run back, get back to God. See, why? Because the grace of God will cover your life so that, watch this, so that growth will manifest. See, watch this. In Psalms chapter, in the 55th division of Psalm, verse number 16, it says this: "As for me, I will call upon God, and the Lord shall save me." Now watch this. That word call means to run to God. See, when we turn to God, God will grace us even in our bad decisions, even in our mistakes, even in our mess ups. God will grace us to get through what we're going through because God is going to manifest growth on the other side. Man, somebody type that in. There is growth on the other side. There is a better me on the other side. There is a better you. Listen, you are better because of what you went through. You are stronger because of what you went through. Yeah, it was your consequence. Yes, it was your bad decision. Yes, it was my bad decision. Yes, it was the consequences for my bad decision. But I'm stronger because of that. I'm wiser because of that. Why? Because God graced me to grow through what I was going through. There is blessings on the other side. There is growth on the other side. There is a better you on the other side of adversity. You just got to understand that God is gracing you to get through it. So don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. Don't quit. You know how many times I wanted to quit? You know how many times I wanted to walk away from God? You know how many times I wanted to stop preaching? Not because of the devil, but because of bad choices, my own bad choices, the consequences of my bad decisions. But God, oh my Lord, have mercy. But God, He graced me, y'all. He graced me to get through. He graced me to grow through. My God, have mercy. Man, listen to y'all. Oh my God, y'all listen, man. Y'all, oh Lord, have mercy. Man, man, y'all gonna make me run in here. Hey, my Lord, have mercy. So that's the first life lesson. That's the first life lesson. What do we do when adversity strikes? What is our response? What should our response be? Number one, the first life lesson, we should turn to God even if our choices cause the adversity. See, here, number two, here's the second life principle. Hallelujah, man. Y'all, man, my God. Watch this. Here's the second life principle. Number two, somebody type this in. Understand that the area of adversity is where God wants us to grow. Somebody type that in for me. Here is the second life principle. What should I do? How should I respond when adversity happens in my life? Number two, second life lesson. Understand that the area of adversity is where God wants us to grow. Someone type that in for me. In other words, whatever area that you're dealing with adversity in your life, that is the area that God is trying to grow you in, that God is trying to mature you in. Understand that the area of adversity is where God wants you to grow. What am I talking about? In Job chapter 3, verse number 25, Job says this. Job has lost his possession. He has lost his cattle. He has lost his children. His wife came to him and said, "Curse God and die." Now watch this. Job says something very interesting in chapter 3, verse number 25. Job says this: "For the thing that I feared the most has come upon me." So think about it. The thing I feared the most has come upon me. Job feared that one day I'll lose my cattle. Job feared that, oh my God, one day I don't know what I'll do if something happened to my children. So the thing that Job feared the most is where he had adversity. My God, I hope y'all getting this. Oh, Lord Jesus, I hope you guys are getting this. See, the thing, listen, read Job 3, verse number 25 for yourself. Job chapter 3, verse number 25, Job says, after he's gone through everything that he's gone through, he says, the thing that I feared the most has happened to me. What am I saying? Life principle number 2, understand that the area of adversity is where God wants you to grow. God didn't want Job fearing. That's why scripture says in the book of Timothy, God has not given us a spirit of fear. So Job was afraid. He had everything that a man could want. He had a beautiful family. He had prosperity. He had wealth. He had respect. He had it all. But somewhere in Job's spirit, he feared that he would lose that one day. And that's exactly the area that God allowed adversity to happen. What am I saying? If you're dealing with adversity in your finances right now, that's the area that God wants you to grow. So what do you need to do? Go find somebody that understands finances better than you. Go find someone that can teach you how to do a budget. Go find someone that can help you understand how to handle money. Because the area that you're experiencing the adversity in is the area that God wants you to grow. If you're experiencing adversity in your marriage right now, it's because God wants your marriage to grow. It's the area that He wants growth. He's trying to manifest growth. So watch this. Don't get discouraged when the enemy attack, when God allows adversity to happen to your finances, to your marriage, to your relationship, boyfriend and girlfriend, to your children, on your job, in your career. Don't listen. If God allows the adversity to happen in any area in your life, that is the area that God is trying to manifest growth in. Good God from Zion. Did y'all get that? Why? Because Romans 8 and 28 says, and we know that all things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to purpose. See, watch this. Watch this. The adversity in the area of your life serves purpose. Think about it, y'all. Think about it. I'll just put it out there. Every area of adversity in my life is where God wanted me to grow up. Jesus, Lord have mercy, y'all. Man, y'all don't know I'm feeling this thing. Every area that I struggle, every area that I failed, every area that I messed up, those were the areas that God wanted to manifest growth. And that's why you need to understand, how do I respond to adversity in my life? Understand that that is the area where God wants you to grow. That's the area that God is trying to grow you up in. That's the area that God is trying to mature you in. That's the area. See, why would God allow adversity to happen in an area that you have under control? Why would God allow adversity to happen that in an area in your life that you got on lock? It's just like temptation. Drugs don't tempt me. That don't tempt me. Money don't tempt me. That stuff don't tempt me. The devil is going to always tempt us in the area that we struggle in. And God is going to always test us in the area that we struggle in. Which simply means the area that you're going through adversity. My God, my God, my God. The area that you're going through adversity in right now, whatever area that is in, I'm telling you, that's the area that God wants you to grow in. That's the area. That is the area. So what should we do when adversity happens in our lives? We should grow through and not go through. What do we do when adversity happens in our lives? We should understand that the area of adversity is where God wants us to grow. And then here's my third and last principle, and I'm done, y'all. Here's my third and last principle, and I'm done. Here it is. Watch this. How do we respond to adversity? How do we grow through adversity? Here's my third life principle. Walk in faith regardless of the adversity that you're facing. Did y'all get that? Here's the third life principle. How do we respond to adversity? What do we do when adversity strikes in our lives? How do we grow through adversity instead of go through adversity? Number three, walk in faith regardless of the adversity that you're facing. Walk in faith regardless of the adversity that you're facing. See, watch this. The main purpose of adversity is to destroy our faith. That's what the devil is up to when adversity comes in our lives, is to destroy our faith. See, watch this, y'all. Watch this. Daniel chapter 6, verse number 16. Daniel was thrown into the lion's den to be destroyed because of his faith. Because of his faith. See, watch this, y'all. Y'all got to get this revelation. See, the adversity that you're going through is actually a testimony that you have faith. Man, listen. See, in Daniel chapter 6, verse number 16, Daniel is thrown into the lion's den. He's experiencing adversity because of his faith. And see, the main purpose of adversity is to destroy our faith. Daniel was dealing with adversity because of his faith in Daniel chapter 6, verse number 16. See, the devil is banking on us losing our faith during our times of trouble, because he knows that faith, watch this, y'all, he knows that faith is the thing that moves the hand of God on our behalf. Oh, Lord have mercy, man. Did y'all get that? You see, faith moves the hand of God on our lives. Faith gets the hand of God involved in our lives. Faith causes the hand of God to move in our situations. Man, listen, I'm telling you, faith is the key. Faith is the key. Listen. That's why Hebrews chapter number 11, verse number 1 says this: and without faith, it is impossible to please God. So it doesn't matter what adversity you're facing, stand in faith. It doesn't matter what you're going through in life, stand in faith. Because as long as you're standing in faith, and in spite of what you're facing, you are pleasing God. You are pleasing God. And if you're pleasing God, he's going to move on your behalf. My God, who is this word for today? See, no matter what you're going through, keep the faith. Faith is what keeps you looking for your breakthrough. Faith is what keeps you fighting. Anytime someone demonstrated faith in the scriptures, it moved the hand of God in their adversity. Oh, my Lord, have mercy. Remember in Matthew chapter 9, verse number 22, the paralyzed man? Faith moved the hand of God. Faith caused his healing. And Matthew chapter 9, verse number 29, the blind man was healed because of faith. In Mark chapter 4, verse number 34, the woman who had adversity for 12 years with the issue of blood was healed because of her faith. You see, God wants you to grow through what you're going through. Don't waste the pain. Get something out of it. So watch this. What do I do when I'm facing adversity? What do I do when I'm going through? You stand in faith. Watch this. You walk in faith regardless of the adversity that you're facing. Walk in faith. Keep believing God. Keep trusting God. Keep serving God. Keep worshiping God. I know it's going to be hard. See, listen, keep believing God even if you got to cry. Keep trusting God even when it feels like, and even when it seems like there is no God. Keep trusting. Keep the faith. Keep believing. Keep believing. No matter what you're facing, I'm telling you, I've been through it. I've faced some of the toughest times in my life, but I kept the faith. I kept the faith. Had to cry sometime, but I kept the faith. I kept the faith. Wanted to give up sometimes, but I kept the faith. Scared sometimes, but I kept the faith. Hurting sometimes, but I kept the faith. I don't know who this is for, but all I hear the Holy Spirit saying to somebody right now, tears are coming in my eyes. Keep the faith. God's going to get you through. Keep the faith. There's growth on the other side of what you're going through. Keep the faith. Keep the faith. Keep the faith. And Father, we thank you. Thank you for this message. I thank you, God, that you have used me to speak to your people. I thank you, God, for the revelation that you brought forth in this teaching message. And I pray, God, for your people that they would simply keep the faith. How do we grow through what we're going through? We keep the faith. Thank you, God. Thank you, Father. Thank you. I pray for the faith of people that are watching this live right now. I pray, God, that they would walk in faith regardless of what they're facing. Their peace is on the other side of adversity. Their prosperity is on the other side of adversity. Their progress, their purpose, and their success is on the other side of adversity. Help them, God, to grow through and not just go through. I thank you, Lord. I give you praise and I give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, amen, y'all. God bless you. I'm sorry. Excuse me. That thing just kind of really got to me, man. But I pray that the Lord has blessed you through this message. And I pray that something that I said really spoke to your spirit. And pray that the Lord will get victory, amen, out of your life. Victory out of your life. Listen, I want to offer Christ to somebody right now. Not church, not religion. I want to offer Christ. I want to offer Christ. What does that mean? That means that you get saved. That means you get born again. What does getting saved? What does born again mean? That means that you believe by faith that Jesus Christ suffered, that he bled, that he died. You believe that he was born of a virgin. You believe that one day he's coming back. And you put your faith in the we call it redemption, the redemptive work of Jesus Christ, that he did it just for you. And when you put your faith in that, and when you believe it, you get born again. So if you want to accept Jesus Christ, if you want to put your faith in the redemptive work of Jesus Christ, just type in right now, I want Christ. Just type in, I want Christ. Not church, not religion, I want Christ. So just type that in for me right now. And while we're waiting to see if someone wants to accept Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, I'm going to ask Beverly to go ahead and put up on the screen the different ways that you can give. There are three different ways that you can give. You can give through Cash App. You can give through going on our website. And you can give through PayPal. So Beverly is going to put those three ways that you can give up on the live in a second. While she's putting those things up, we're going to go ahead and pray for our offering, pray over our giving. Father, in the name of Jesus, your word says that give and it shall be given, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Your word says to bring all of the tithe into the storehouse. And so, God, we know that in obedience is blessings. And so, God, it is in obedience that we bring our gifts to you. It is in obedience that we bring our tithe and our offerings to you. God, we ask your blessings of our obedience. Bless our obedience and bless our faith to give. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that our quivers will not run dry. We pray, oh God, that we would have more than enough. We pray, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that you would cause us to walk in divine prosperity, walk in divine blessings because of our obedience. So I thank you now for those people who will obey and give and tithe into the local church. I ask your blessings, your continued blessings be upon them, that they will always have seed in their hand to sow and to give to your local church. I thank you for it in advance. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, amen. God bless y'all, man. God bless y'all. I'm sorry. I got a little emotional at the end there. But those of you that have been following me long enough, y'all know that I'm just a big crybaby anyway. So, Lord have mercy. But that thing just, man, keep the faith. That's all I keep hearing in my spirit. Keep the faith, y'all. Keep the faith. That's what I keep hearing in my spirit. Keep the faith. Keep the faith. Listen, it has been a blessing and an honor to be able to share this word with you guys today. I pray that something that I shared gave you strength. I pray that something that I shared with you was a blessing to you. God really spoke to your spirit about growing through. Don't just go through in life, grow through. Listen, give a couple of shout outs. I see Dr. Bishop Harold Krause in Georgia. Pastor Krause, thank you so much for joining me this morning, man. It's an honor and a privilege to have you on the live. Love you, brother. You and your wife. Blessings to y'all, man. Hope to see you soon when I'm in Georgia. Lakeisha Sings, love you. Who else? My auntie. I saw my auntie Mary Doster Green on live. Love you, auntie. God bless you. Who else? Angela Knight. Angela Knight, God bless you there. Yeah, Angela, keep the faith, man. That's what I keep hearing in my spirit. Even now, God is saying, keep the faith. Don't give up. Pastor Krause, thank you for the word. I was blessed. Bless you, man. I'm glad you were blessed. I'm glad you were blessed, Dr. Krause. Appreciate your support, man. Thank you for tuning in. Dr. Krause says, bring your golf game. Of course, man. I take it everywhere I go. Who else I saw? I saw Kyrie on here earlier. God bless you, Kyrie. I saw Stacy. Stacy, God bless you. Toby, love you, bless you. Pastor Sonia Gordon was on. God bless you, Pastor Sonia Gordon. Nika, Ambitious Girl Harvey, God bless you, dear. Who else was on earlier? Stephanie Walker, homegirl from Pompano, exit 36. God bless you, dear. God bless you. Who else we have on there? I wanted to just give everybody I could a shout out. Mary Doster Green, my auntie, my mother's sister. God wants me to keep the faith. Thank you, Pastor. Auntie, you are so welcome. I don't know. I'm telling you, I don't know who that was for, but that's what really touched my heart. I just heard the Holy Spirit saying, just simply tell them to keep the faith. It's not hard. It's not rocket science. Just keep the faith. On the other side of adversity, I'm telling you, everything you've been praying for is on the other side of adversity. Just keep the faith. Amen, Auntie. I'm glad that it was for you and it was a blessing for you. It was a blessing for me and it was for me too. So God bless you, Auntie. I love you. God bless you. Well, listen, man, I pray that y'all have a blessed week. I pray that you guys will walk in this word. Pastor Floyd, I told her to receive this word. God bless you, man. Bless you, Dr. Floyd. Brother Gene Kerr, thank you for the word, Pat. You're welcome, Brother Gene Kerr. Love you, man. Bless you, boss man. Auntie, thank you. Thank you, Auntie, for tuning in. I appreciate you. Love you. Listen, man, y'all have a great week. Y'all have a great week this week. Like I said, I'm going to leave those three words with y'all, man. Keep the faith. I hear it so strongly in the spirit. I hear it so strongly in the spirit. Keep the faith. Keep the faith. Listen, I love you. God bless you. And again, I pray that you have a blessed week. And don't forget to give. Don't forget to tithe. Don't forget to share. God bless you. Love you. Again, God wants you to win. God wants you to win. God bless y'all. Take care.